I say this here because in EPP we believe in science, we believe in R&D, and we believe in politics based on facts and knowledge. And in the parliament, we fight hard to place science and facts at the core of policy and decision making.
It's colleague Lydia Pereira from Portugal that gets the floor first.
Thank you, Esther, for giving me the floor. And I would also like to thank Dr. Zaks for your valuable contribution for this debate. And I say this not only as a formality. I say this here because in EPP, we believe in science, we believe in R&D, and we believe in politics based on facts and knowledge. And in the parliament, we fight hard to place science and facts at the core of policy and decision making. We are very proud of this in the EPP. And once again, I would like to thank for helping us in fighting disinformation and providing a more informed view on the matter. My question is related to the myths and disinformation that grows amidst our society concerning vaccines. This is a very, very worrying matter. And I speak not only as an MEP, but also as the president of the youth of the EPP, and that together with President Tusk and in particular Chairman Weber, to whom I would like to thank for organizing and congratulate the engagement that they've shown on this topic. We are preparing a European-wide campaign about vaccination. And this campaign highlights the benefits of vaccination and how we need to work towards immunization to globally overcome this virus. So what is your take on the form on this from a medical and from an industry perspective? Should we, for instance, Europe and member states have targeted campaigns to schools as kids also have influence in their parents? Should we perhaps partner with the social media platforms in joint efforts to overcome this situation? So what does the industry and you particularly think about this matter? And thank you very much once again.
And thanks. So let's bring in Dr. Zaks straight away. There was a question about myth busting and also the lessons learned, both addressed to you. So we look forward to your answer there.
Yeah, so let me take the first one on myth-busting or education. I think this is a really critical. One of the things I've learned in the past year, you know, I'm somebody who spent his life translating science into medicine, and like Professor Sahin, the pace of science has just been bewildering, and the physicians want to translate it quickly into medicine. But the truth is, if you don't translate medicine into the politics and education, then you won't get access and the medicines won't have an impact. And I think that on vaccines, vaccines are one of the greatest inventions of modern mankind, and I say modern with a view in the rearview mirror, in terms of the healthcare benefits have just been astounding to our societies. And I think in the past decades, we've grown complacent about them. And so we've stopped talking about them. But even the childhood vaccines that we have, we've forgotten the world that would exist if we didn't have these vaccines. And I think COVID is giving us an opportunity to demonstrate that from a medical and educational perspective, because the unmet need is palpable and surrounding us. Now, from an industrial perspective, I think we're at the forefront of seeing innovation being applied to vaccines. It's been difficult, relatively speaking, to get as excited about vaccines historically in terms of an investment thesis. I think COVID is changing that, and I'm very grateful to be at the forefront of that. But we do need partnership with the people who people trust. And this is where I look to partners in the political world to be able to make that message. For myself, I can tell you I have only two tools. One is to share our data transparently. And the other one is to tell you that I believe in it. You know, I've been vaccinated. My mom's been vaccinated. My kids are in line to get vaccinated. We think that this is a very important tool.